The U.S. is set to hold its presidential elections in November. How do you expect political developments in the U.S. to affect the consistency of their Indo-Pacific strategy?
Well, you know, I think that with the visit of Secretary Blinken, he sought to reaffirm the U.S. commitment towards the Philippines, regardless of any political situation. And I know there are concerns regarding the trajectory of the post-election scenario in the U.S., but I think that we are at a time where countries like the Philippines and the nature of our alliance with the United States are far too crucial to disregard. And I think that there are concerns over the potential of a more transactional government, and I think that this was also the case between the U.S. and Japan under the previous U.S. administration. But of course, we have to see that the Philippines is in that position where it is willing to enhance its own agency and not just serve as an extension of any alliance. And this is where we see that proactivity and at least that level of willingness to play a larger role. So I think this would go a long way in ensuring that the U.S.-Philippine alliance remains intact. However, the future is still uncertain, but as far as we can tell, you know, the visit of Secretary Blinken was to reaffirm that consistency in the U.S.-Philippine relationship.
Right. Ron, while President Marcos Jr. has been quite successful in courting the support of Japan, Australia, Western democracies like Germany, Czech Republic, and especially the United States, he has yet to gain solid support on the home court, here on the turf in the Southeast Asian region. What else can Manila do to rally more support against China's expansionist agenda here in Southeast Asia?
Right. So, you know, I think there is a clear realization in Manila that, of course, some Southeast Asian countries may not be comfortable or at least may be still quite wary of Manila's more proactive position in the West Philippine Sea, particularly in engaging with our extra-regional partners that seek to enhance their diplomatic footprints here as well. But we have to remember that what Manila is doing is basically ensuring that its sovereignty and sovereign rights remain intact, that the West Philippine Sea remains open, rules-based, and also inclusive and free. And this is, of course, very important given our limited resources and our desire to improve our maritime security capabilities. But on the other hand, we have also ensured the process of socialization vis-a-vis our neighbors. We have been in constant communication with our Southeast Asian neighbors to explain the situation as well. And I think that the Philippine Coast Guard has also released a particular statement a few weeks ago regarding the need to look at the transparency initiative as something that is non-provocative, but something that seeks to ensure Philippine interests, but also in areas that are of common concern to Southeast Asian countries, such as food security, health, etc., marine health. So this is, of course, our way of showing that, you know, our concerns are collective. But of course, looking at ASEAN's history, there have been certain challenges in absorbing or accepting political or security shifts, such as the ASEAN outlook on the Indo-Pacific, which started off through the initiative of Indonesia, but was looked at warily by other Southeast Asian countries. So the socialization process became an eventual success in time. So what we are trying to do is we're trying to socialize our neighbors regarding what is actually happening on the ground. But of course, that we have to keep our options open. ASEAN is very important to us, but we also have to look into other options, complementary options, to ensure that our people and our sovereignty and sovereign rights are remain intact.
And Don, how optimistic are you that Manila can still count on its immediate neighbors when it comes to China's aggression in the South China Sea, or even in the event of an attack from China, considering that several nations in Southeast Asia are quite dependent on Asia's largest economy?
Right. And it's not about being optimistic, but we have to be practical about it. And we have to understand the limitations of our partnership within ASEAN. And this is why I think that there have been initiatives that are sub-regional in nature. For example, our trilateral with Indonesia and Malaysia that goes beyond the collective ASEAN framework. And this shows, of course, that there's also willingness and recognition within ASEAN members of the limitations of the bloc. Particularly in issues of hard security. And of course, understanding that China plays an undeniable role in the economic stability and, of course, the economic activity in Southeast Asian states, that it would be difficult to, of course, expect certain Southeast Asian countries to become more vocal towards what is happening in the West Philippine Sea. We've had Vietnam, for example, who has been quite consistent in calling out China's belligerence within our EEZ. But of course, there are other countries that are more wary of triggering any sort of heated debate with Beijing for these reasons. And of course, secondly, Southeast Asian countries have varying threat perceptions. So mainland Southeast Asian countries often do not look at the security of the South China Sea, for example, as an immediate concern. However, we are looking at certain levels of progress, such as the first ever joint maritime drills, which has, despite the fact that the locations were changed, this has shown, of course, how there is that ability to socialize Southeast Asian countries towards certain areas, such as maritime security. But of course, this won't be easy for us. So we have to keep our options open, and we are doing that both at the international level, with like-minded partners at the international level. And we are also doing proactive engagements within our country, the passing of the Maritime Zones Act, for example, the creation of our comprehensive archipelagic policy are things that complement these initiatives as well. So I think that we are following a multi-pronged approach.
Right, and we will have to wait and see how President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. will perform in Washington next month. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us this morning, geopolitical analyst Don McLean-Gale.
Thank you, Kat. Have a great day.